Okay, guys. Meredith, let's start with you. In the aftermath of the financial crisis, when banks like yours were doing probably a lot of soul searching, looking for the way forward, what culturally happened within Bank of America to allow you to do this? I mean, this is sort of out of your wheelhouse
at that point. Yeah, no, that's a great question. And, you know, coming out of the financial crisis, our company really transformed dramatically. Really, when Brian Moynihan became the CEO in 2010, made a lot of decisions about how to simplify the company, de-risk the company, but most importantly, how we become a customer-driven company. And as part of that, restated the purpose of the company, which is making financial lives better, one connection at a time. And that became the focus of everything we did, is to really anchor everything in the customer view. And, you know, it's funny, we look at it a couple different ways. One is customer as user, so the stuff they need from us. But the other is how the customer thinks as the citizen view, to say they want to be part of something bigger and also want to work with a company that has values. So this became, as we really thought about customer driven, how we evaluated, how we looked at things became very different.
In that same vein, what was it like for the employees of the company culturally?
Yeah, big transformation. And what we also talked about, recognizing there was so much of a decline in trust, erosion in trust in the industry, everyone's heard about that. What we also saw was an erosion in trust of all big corporations. So we did this big pivot to say, we can't act like an institution anymore. We had to act more like a human. And we said, we're entering the human era. And so we really changed our language, changed how we talked, and said, we need to be a much more human, empathetic, understanding company and be more eye to eye with our customers. So that was one of the biggest evolutions, is understanding everything has to be focused on the customer and to be more of a human era company.
Would have been, it must have happened at the very top to be able to turn that battleship around relatively quickly.
It did. I mean, that purpose statement was written by Brian Moynihan, and it was a real belief that he had that we had to be customer driven in everything we did and really give people a framework to make decisions, to make investment decisions, marketing decisions, product decisions. The end user in mind always has to be the customer.
Deborah, from your perspective at Red, what was the very genesis of this from your perspective, and how did it evolve?
Well, I believe Brian met Bono in Dublin. They worked on something, and then Brian Moynihan invited Bono to Georgetown to give a speech on how to be an activist. And there were about 700 students, and everybody was like breathless after the speech. And he said, you know, is there more that we could be doing together? So Red and Bank of America were involved in conversations actually long before the band got involved. But the band, U2, has always supported Red. So their last tour, they gave $11 million towards Red and the Global Fund. So they, I guess you would know then how the creative came out, right?
Well, even before then, which is sort of interesting, is, you know, we, before the crisis, were really a domestic company. And afterwards, we were now a global company. Yeah. And if you think about the things that we support, most of them were in the United States. And it was very important for us to align ourselves with a cause that was outside of the United States. So that was very interesting. And in part of the conversations that we originally had with Red, it was realizing that there was a cure in sight. This is something that was achievable. And that was very powerful to us. And the fact the American public had played such a big role under Presidents Bush, Presidents Clinton, that there was a lack of awareness of how much the United States had been involved in this, and that there was an achievable goal that could put us over the finish line, was something that was very engaging, very interesting to us to get involved with.
Spencer, I'll get to you in 2 seconds, but Deborah, can you just give us a quick update about the crisis and where
you see it? Yeah, so, I mean, you know, AIDS is 32 years old, so it's not, something that's been around all that long, and it's completely ravaged the planet with 35 million that have died. That's the size of the population of Canada, so imagine no Canada. And 36 million still have the disease. And there is a real pivotal turning point now. The antiretroviral a medication to keep you alive costs about 40 cents a day. 10 million are now on that medication. And 70% of the people that do have the disease are in sub-Sahara Africa. So that's where the main focus is. But what we've determined quite recently, and in the last 10 years have made enormous strides, is that when you're on the medication, you then are less likely to transmit the disease to your baby if you're pregnant. And so we've sort of eliminated the transmission of HIV in Europe, in the United States, but it's quite rampant in Africa. In the last 10 years, we've been able to halve it. So it was 1,100 a day that was giving HIV to their babies, and now it's 500. And so we can see a path, and to your point, track it. We know where we have to go, what needs to be done. This is the UN, it's not red. It's the world coming together to say, can we stop the transmission and get it to, you know, sort of like polio, virtual elimination, where it's a very small percentage. And then you have a generation that grows up without the disease. And that's one of the trigger points, quite frankly, of the beginning of the end of AIDS, because it's a pandemic, and then, boom, it starts to really, really decrease. So that's such positive news in, you know, a disease that's just been sort of a lot of bad news for so many years. So to have the awareness and the breadth of Bank of America and their commitment for $10 million, which is just, you know, game-changing in a country like Ghana and some of the places that we work, was really awe-inspiring to us.
So Spencer, you know, working with Bank of America, Red, and you too, let's not forget those guys, that's a pretty heavy creative lift. Tell us how you initially approached it.
Yeah, well, I mean, so just to back up just for a second, to a certain extent, AIDS had been in the back burner of the American consciousness. You know, it's been around for a very long time. It's incredibly devastating. But I think that people had really not put it in the front of their minds. And then when we found out that there was this opportunity to, by 2015, hopefully end mother-to-child transmission of HIV, it was this amazing thing. We just thought about what's the biggest podium? I mean, this kind of news, this kind of opportunity, the biggest podium you can possibly have is the Super Bowl. And so the combination of Bank of America and Red partnering with you two, from a creative standpoint, obviously was like, yeah, you know, where do we sign up? I mean, right. It was just incredible. So, you know, we brought a little reel here if we want to play that.
Okay, here we go.
Ending mother-to-child transmission of HIV and delivering the first AIDS-free generation is within our grasp. And so, at the 2014 World Economic Forum in Davos, Switzerland, a rock star and a banker stand together. U2 and Bank of America announce a partnership with Red to fight AIDS. U2 will play their new song on a Super Bowl ad and make it available for free on iTunes for 24 hours. For every download, Bank of America will donate $1 to Red. Buzz in the media and on social channels is huge. A clock in Times Square counts down to the moment U2 will play. A teaser goes online and the buzz builds. On game day, U2 posts the ad to Facebook and tweets a Vine. The ad airs. Immediately after, the clock in Times Square resets and the 24-hour countdown begins. Mobile, tablet, and online sites take advantage of the biggest second screen audience of the year. The first ever Facebook ad with a download button enables downloads directly from iTunes. Celebrities and influencers with huge social followings post about the free song and the donation to Red. The song is downloaded over a million times in the first hour alone. Tweets and shares continue to pour out into the world. The clock hits zero, the time is up. The results are remarkable. A band, a bank, and a cause that for 24 hours transformed an audience into an army. And the beginning of the end of AIDS has begun.
With that preamble, great video. Can you talk about again, sort of the how you began to approach this very heavy?
So, as soon as we found out that U2 was going to be offering their newest song for free download for a period of time during and after the Super Bowl. I mean, obviously that became the key thought. We started out, and I can tell you the process, as you'd imagine, virtually everybody within the agency wanted to take part in this thing. We had tons and tons of teams. I think we went through over 120 different concepts that we took forward, in some cases to the band, in some cases to the client, and just internally. And at the end of the day, I think we came to the conclusion, which, you know, in hindsight is a bit of a duh moment, but at the end of the day, I think the thinking was, when you have a group of artists the stature of you two, and they're going to be putting a new song out there, we just thought the best thing to do would be to get out of the way and let the song play, literally. I mean, just get it out there, have the song play, craft our messaging around it, making sure that everybody understood that there was this amazing moment and building a sense of urgency to say that if we do this and we do this together, that we really can make this enormous stride in the fight against AIDS.
Meredith, discuss the early stages from Bank of America's perspective. Why take on this now? And to Deborah's point earlier, can a bank really be an activist?
Yeah, that's a great question. So first of all, if you look at how we approach things from a corporate social responsibility lens, we feel we have a responsibility, and particularly coming out of the crisis, the role we play, and you think about a company our size, the size and scale, and the connections we have. So we operate in over 40 countries. We have close to 240,000 employees, 5,100 banking centers. We've got scale that we can leverage, and if we bring our resources and partner with, in this case, a nonprofit or the public or the private sector, we can make something happen. We can have an impact on things that matter in the world. So we've done it before in the past, and it's interesting, we've had a model where we have a participatory model, how we engage with the public. So we've done things before when our military was coming home, how we could help them and partner with a nonprofit to raise funds to help them re-enter society. We've done things with Feeding America. So we have a bit of a track record of knowing if we take our heft and our scale and apply it to something that matters and partner with the public, we can make it work. And in this case, it was the same kind of a thing. The issue here was we hadn't really done anything outside of the United States. So it was important to do something globally. Africa matters from a business standpoint. And what was really attractive was this notion that we're almost there, that this is solvable and we can get there. The time is now. Bono talks about we have to put heat on this issue now, and that was something that really sparked to say, you know what, if we apply our resources and this participation, we can create a movement to put it over the finish line.
Deborah, why a bank? Why was there any pause when you were approaching this sort of post-financial crisis? Any concern that that would have a taint on this?
I think that the band, which is very quick to spot injustice and to tell it like it is, was very outspoken during the time of the financial crisis about regulatory rules and everything. But what, I think they look for, and I certainly don't want to speak for them, but I'll speak for Red, is authenticity. And we had spent a lot of time, quite frankly, with Bank of America and the team. And the reach, which Meredith talked about, is, one out of two households. So the mission of Red is awareness and to create heat on this issue so that it's still on the political agenda, so that a new generation knows about it, knows that we can actually end this thing, and to generate money. And so at Davos, when Bank of America put on the table $10 million, it was then matched by the Gates Foundation, it was then matched, SAP put in money, the Mosepi family in Africa. So right away that turned to $22 million in one swoop. You put that together with the 240,000 employees, the banking centers, the Super Bowl. So thank goodness we were in the first quarter, so people watched. And the reach was amazing, amazing. And so the fact that also they were willing to make it worldwide, we had to keep in mind, there's the people in Ireland that's going to want that U2 track. So Bank of America right away was like, nope, it's global, let's do it. So everything came together, and I have to say, even the creative, you know, perhaps read, let a bank be more provocative and more artistic and a little bit, you know, less banky. And that's a good thing. And I'm sure the employees appreciated it and still do, so.
Spencer, can you talk about the three-way partnership between you guys and what were some of the creative teaching moments that you learned along the way?
Creative teaching moments. Well, I think it was interesting because the clients were several. It was I mean that in a good way. Red and Bank of America, and also you two played a very strong role. So it's kind of interesting when you're taking people through work, and in this case on some calls it was. Larry and Adam and Bono and the Edge, and it's tempting to kind of be a little bit in awe, and clearly this is a group of people who are incredibly talented and have been on the world stage for many, many years, but at the end of the day, their attention to craft and their attention to just making everything perfect, there were a lot of similarities. So that was, I think, one real teaching moment is they had a level of respect for our process and our work that we certainly have always had for theirs. So,
and maybe speak a little bit more about what it was like to work with the band creatively, and how did they shape the creative messaging going as you went through the process?
Well, one thing that it was just a little anecdote that's pretty interesting, and that is obviously Bono is the front man, literally, he's the lead singer, and he and the Edge have more, I think, public-facing personas than perhaps Larry and Adam. But when it came to reviewing work with them, it's a democracy. We present an idea, and you'd hear someone on the phone, Bono, saying, "Oh, that seems very interesting, and let's talk about that." And then in the back, you'd hear Larry kind of go, "Eh." You know, and it that meant move on, and everyone had an equal voice, and the four of them needed to agree that whatever they were going to go out with was going to be representative of all the work they've done in the past. So they all had to like it. So again, that's why ultimately the work we did was essentially it's a music video, but it's a beautiful one, and Mark Romanek, the director, really had a huge role in the vision of this spot. Mark Romanek first saw U2 in a bar in 1978 in London, where he saw them play live when they were really in their nascent stage. And he just said that kind of punk energy and grittiness that they brought to that performance, he could never get it out of his head. And it was his vision to try to recreate that grittiness and that kind of black and white, raw performance, kind of interacting with the crowd vibe.
Meredith, talk about the Super Bowl. I mean, you have a creative and media background before you were in banking. How did you come to say, yes, let's pony up for that big outlay? And I guess, was that the only stage you could play this on?
Yeah, you know, very early on, we made that decision. It was obvious. It was screamingly obvious. We said, this is going to be a movement. And you know, at first, we thought we'd only do something for our customers. And very quickly said, we can't. This has to be for the public. It has to be on the biggest stage there is. And no doubt, the Super Bowl is the biggest media moment. But what we also did surrounding that was what we call a few never been done before. And this is really interesting, too. As we engaged the media community on this and we went to them, there was so much energy around this. Just wasn't another brief or another assignment that was put out there. There was so much interest in everyone getting behind what the mission here was. So when we work with Facebook, we work with Twitter, you saw on the video some of those never been dones. The post on Facebook, you could go directly and download to iTunes. On Twitter, we did two things. One, we did this, a little video that we teased, and one, we had the full 60-second opened up automatically on Twitter. And those were things that were done, never been done, but they had an interest in working with us on this big stage. So social media played an enormous role, but certainly the centerpiece for this, no doubt, was the Super Bowl.
Deborah, what's next? Will you try to attach this partnership to other large global events like the Olympics and the World Cup? How do you pay this forward?
Well, I mean, we keep thinking that we haven't yet tapped into all the ATMs and the windows and everything with the employees that Bank of America brings to the table. So we're looking at the next big thing. Could be World AIDS Day, could be a sporting event, but we're working on it and it will be creative and big.
Obviously, in the clip, there's a reference to how intense the social media attention was around this. Spencer, can you talk about social as a creative accelerant, and how did it function with this campaign?
Well, we had the luxury of Reds and Bank of America's Rolodexes, for lack of a better word, and some literal friends of the bank and Red and the band, frankly, tweeted and pushed out the thought that, you know, get involved in this, download the song, and Bank of America will donate a dollar to Red in the fight against AIDS. So everybody from Miley Cyrus to Maria Shriver to Jimmy Fallon, I mean, it was remarkable. And I think that was huge. And then the retweets that just followed from that, people getting behind this thing. And again, I think you can't underestimate the amazing, and I'm going to use the word again, luxury of having a song by U2 to be downloaded. So the cause was noble and continues to be noble, and the work is great, and the spot is beautiful. But at the end of the day, the song is a great song by a great band, and I don't think we can ever underestimate the fact that people wanted the song. And it also helped that U2 had not released a new song for many years.
And just the lyrics, I mean, the fact that it was called Invisible and it would go away, and that the lyrics were, you know, it's not them, there's only us, it just was very, very powerful.
Going forward, would there be a live component of performance that would sort of help continue this push to the final end?
One never knows the creative process of U2.
And if that was to happen, would these guys be involved too? Like, how would the
one
partnership...
never knows who would be involved
in right.
U2?
Yes.
We hope
personally
yes.
involved.
Yeah. We hope
how can
yes.
I get tickets?
Yeah.
I mean, it was great because Hill Holliday had pro bono worked with Red for years, and so this came up so fast. And I think if we all weren't like, you know, I don't know that it would have come together like it did. But you know, on Red social messaging, we also have Apple, Starbucks, Coca-Cola. So Bank of America was joining. We reached 6 million on our own of followers, but then our partners, their employees, their Facebook, you know, it was just massive that, you know, we could reach 300 million like that with it.
I mean, the volume was incredible, and to your point, it's the song, but I think there was some nuance there that people understood what was happening. We track social sentiment very carefully, and we've tracked it since the financial crisis, and typically, social sentiment is negative. People usually go to social media to say something bad. They don't usually say good things about a company. We'd had a couple days prior to this where we had positive social sentiment around the brand launch and around some stuff we did with the military. One day. We had four consecutive days of positive social sentiment because people enjoyed what this was all about.
Right.
And they understood, like, hey, and even people would say, I might not love Bank of America, but I get what you're doing, and this is smart and it makes sense. And you're moving in the right direction and starting to forgive you. And so it was starting to get the feel of, yeah, the song was part of it, but I think a lot of people saw the bigger picture of what the bank was trying to do.
And I think the participatory nature of the entire, I mean, there was a barn-raising vibe to the whole thing that if we all get together and we do this, that we have this opportunity to push this over the finish line. I think the urgency is also something that it is so within sight, this goal of ending mother-to-child transmission of HIV, and I think by bringing this subject up again and giving people the notion that this is doable. I mean, this Bono said it in a lot of his interviews. You know, this war that has ravaged humanity for 30-something years is about to be over, and we're going to win. And all we need now is to really just get behind it for that final push.
Yeah, to that point, I would say it disrupts philanthropy when you can have masses participate in a very easy way that's effective and makes them feel like, you know, one, they've done something, and then on the policy side, we can't do it without the private sector. So to have Bank of America come in such a big way and everybody to see in 24 hours, $3.1 million, no money taken out, just goes direct on the ground, it was so impactful. And I think that's what people track now, and there's transparency and accountability, and to be with a bank that lets that happen, and you know, we have a clock and this is what's happened, I think everybody felt good about participating.
Spencer, I mean, this campaign was pretty multi-dimensional, multi-screened, ranging from 140 characters to the Super Bowl.
Right.
Talk about that, and were there things that you wanted to try creatively that you didn't and maybe will in the future?
As far as things that we wanted to try, there were a lot of ideas on the table that had more of a narrative story arc kind of structure to them, more traditional 60-second beginning, middle, and an end spot. And some of them were funny, and some of them were very, very powerful, and some of them were very moving. There's none that were left on the table that I look back and say, I wish I had done that instead of. There are a lot that are on the table that I look back and say, I wish I had done that, just, you know, I hope to again. But I think compared to what we did and the results, there's nothing that I regret. But as far as the multi-channels, I mean, everything from social to Meredith's point about the first ever Facebook ad unit that you could download directly from iTunes to using the bank's digital billboard in Times Square. After the announcement of Davos, we put up this clock that really counted down to the Super Bowl when you have the moment to download the song. And it says the beginning of the end of AIDS starts in, you know, 80 hours, 79 hours, all the way to kickoff of the Super Bowl. And when the ad played, we reset the clock to 24 hours and said, you know, this is how much time you have to really join this fight. So, and the multi-screen aspect, as the video said, you know, it's I don't know definitively if it's the largest second screen audience of the year, but it's got to be, you know, in the top couple. And understanding that many people are interacting with a bunch of different devices while they're at Super Bowl parties and watching this, we need to give them an opportunity to you know, engage with the content anywhere. But as far as things left on the table that I'd wish I had done, no, not compared to this.
How did you and the bank get involved creatively with the campaign?
So we were, as Spence mentioned, we were part of the process reviewing. I mean, at the end of the day, candidly, I think the band probably was the end client.
They were.
It's their IP rights. It's their face, their name, which we were very respectful of. You know, also this appeared on bankofamerica.com. We had our own on our site as well as on another place on our website. And, you know, it was important for them to, as they're being associating with the bank, how they maintain their image is critical, and we were very respectful of that. So we were partners here, but I would say the creative process was largely driven, I would say, more with the band and the agency, mm-hmm. and we were part of it, but certainly they were the influencers.
How about you, Deborah? How are you involved with the creative in Red? How are you and Red involved with the creative?
Red, just so everybody knows, is 14 people, and we're a few blocks away. And so, I mean, I keep thinking back on the things that would come from Hill Holliday and Bank of America on, like, crisis management, for example. If this ends up going down or if this doesn't work, you know, here's Team Bank of America. It would be like 50 people. And then here's the team at Hill Holliday. And then if you need Red, call Zach. Like, there's one guy. And I'm laughing because some of the team is here. And we had like a station set up in Williamsburg. And you know, we're all drinking beers and hoping everything goes OK, because we really are too small. And like Blanche DuBois, Streetcar Named Desire, we just rely on the kindness of strangers to really know what they're doing. All we kept doing was trying to say, you know, it's Red, you can get away with anything. It gives you permission, because people want Red to be something different, something big, and something that leaves you with a little bit of a smirk or leaves you thinking it's provocative. So, you know, pretty much creatively, anything they wanted to do, we were like, yeah, and then just push it a little bit further. And
it was just brilliant, the whole process.
And it was the consistency too. If you look on that video, everything was the same. It was the same message. And so we did work very hard to get that language exact. So I say that was the role that we played very closely with Red and with Hill, is let's get that language and not say too many things and just be consistent and drive it out through everything that we were doing.
And then on the policy side, you know, we had to vet it to make sure everything was absolutely accurate, because you don't want to say something grandiose, you know, and then have it not be. So we're very careful about the words that we choose, and that it's, you know, endorsed by the UN, and that everybody is behind it on the policy side.
I mean, conceptually, these guys kept us on track, because we did have a lot of ideas that might have overstated, you know, this is going to be the cure, or language like that, and it's just, it's not. I mean, the end is in sight, but we couldn't overpromise.
Deborah, you were saying last night that Bono is very, very creative, but a very intense person in terms of, you know, really wanting to get things very perfect all the time. Did he talk with you through this process and help guide the you know,
absolutely.
The very tone
I mean,
his,
you know, you might guess, he's quite hands-on. He's not, you know, aloof there in Dublin. He's in everybody's face in a good way, trying to make it as great as it can be, because, you know, he has his, you know, reputation on the policy side with world leaders, with the band. He's a father and got four kids and a wife, and so he's balancing all these things to have maximum impact. And so it had to be huge, it had to be really good, it had to have impact and have a high return. So, you know, all the way through, and there were moments where we thought, oh, what if nobody comes? What if we put on the party and not that many download? You know, it's scary because you're putting yourself out there. So I think it was a great leap for you two to take as well.
As far as the relentlessness, you know, in the context of this Super Bowl ad, it was also a band trying out a new song in a very public venue for the first time. So the relentlessness with which they pursued it, I mean, I'll admit, I'm a fanboy, and you know, it'd be like take one, and he was like, all right, good, you know, let's rap. That was beautiful, you know, and 4 days later, we're still doing it. And so it kind of got through to you that this is a really amazing cause, but at the end of the day, it's also a group of guys who are just relentless in their attention to detail and making sure it's perfect. And there was the craft aspect of that, and just not wanting to leave anything, you know, out there that they didn't think they could have made better, every single aspect of it.
Meredith, going through this process is probably a pretty powerful process, and powerful enough to maybe change the bank's thinking and culture. Did you see a discernible change inside the bank from your perspective culturally after this was over?
I'll tell you, the employee reaction was outstanding. It was just so overwhelming. And also, talk about the craftsmanship. We did a video for employees. Bono did a 2-minute video just coming on our intranet talking about it. It took an hour and a half to get a 2-minute video. So the passion to get the words right, to have it perfect.
You guys just in a room together working on it together, right?
Exactly.
That's pretty intense.
And you know, sometimes he wanted to say it a certain way, and I said, you really can't say that at the bank. And so that was kind of an interesting, you know, recognition. He's like, but I'm a rock star. I'm like, I know, but we're a bank. And so there were a couple
don't
times.
Curse.
Yeah.
Cursing,
and don't curse.
Good.
There were a few curse words that were deleted. It just doesn't fly. And I'm like, I know you're cool, but that's not going to fly. But it just showed his passion for making this right. And it came through in the video. And people really engage with this, and they just want more. And so we have a company store where half the proceeds that we sell go to Red, that are Red branded materials people are buying. In fact, Deb and I are speaking in New York at One Bryant Park next week to talk to the employees, you know, a similar discussion there. There's just a lot of interest. Our employees volunteer over 2 million hours a year. So this is core to who we are as a company, to give back to our communities. This is just a larger community on the global scale.
How about at Red? Did it change Red's culture?
It did. I think that we were surprised how great it was to work with Bank of America. And I'm not saying
that's
that
okay.
because they're, you're here, because I'd probably just as honestly say, there were bumps. The creative process and everything, we were sort of taken aback that they were willing to take risks. They thought out of the box. You know, we had thought that it was going to feel very corporate, and it didn't. And in fact, you know, everybody within Red was reminded of some of those early days of the Gap stores turning red, and we felt that this was really big and breathtaking, and Bank of America let us do that. So again, we're small, and if we could have a bank like Bank of America come in and let us have awareness and money to the Global Fund on that scale, it was humbling, and we're hungry. And so we were just, internally surprised at how great it was. Like, we really felt good at the end of the day.
Are there any other causes the bank would like to tackle creatively and with messaging?
And as I said, right now, we are still actively involved in supporting our returning military. Hunger is an important cause of ours. There are some women's efforts, and that really ties nicely here, too, because it is about the mother to child. So those are really from that stage of environmental issues that we partake in. We've got actually a fairly vast portfolio, but you can only do so many big things that you're going to market to get people behind.
Spencer, did you learnings that you can apply to your creative work on other clients?
I want to use you two for everything.
Yeah.
or another rock band, every client, every product. I think it teaches you, even though you'd think that we wouldn't have to be taught, and to a certain extent we don't, it's just, I guess, further proof that a level of collaboration between client, between agency, between Red, between the band, between the band's management, the lines really blurred, and it really was a bit of a check your ego at the door, because when you're dealing with everything about this project seemed larger than life, the enormity of the cause, the enormity of the band with which we were working, just from a physical standpoint, you know, 1,300 extras in an airport hangar and seven cameras and just everything was bigger. And then kind of from a conceptual standpoint or from sort of a morality standpoint, the cause and the level of humanity that was involved was bigger than any one person. So I guess long-winded way of saying that I think that just be ready to collaborate probably more than you ever have before.
We have a little bit of time left. Any questions from the audience? I think we have some microphones. Don't be shy. Go ahead. Speak into the mic, please, so we can hear you. There's one there, and there's one there.
So actually, I kind of curiosity, what is the decision process to hold this partnership, this event? Because if you working like with other each groups as a partnership, there are a lot of, you know, not agreement of some decision making decision. So even like client side, agency side, and Red, you know, the group, they're all three different groups. Mm-hmm. And then it's probably there are some point that there are not really agreements on certain things. So what I kind of want to curiosity, like, what is the process? Who really making a decision in the end, like a very core decision process?
Yeah, that's a terrific question. And a lot of conference calls, a lot of time on the phone, a lot of weekends, because it was a lot of complexity. And though we all had a common goal, we all were coming at it a little bit differently, frankly, when you've got so many different parties involved. So it was always reestablishing what is the objective? Because if you keep going back to the objective, it will help you get to that point. And so oftentimes we're having good debate and discussion about, you know, when you, whether or not, you know, we think about the Super Bowl, what tactics we should be using. So there could be some back and forth on that, but every time we would just continue to go back to what is it that we're trying to achieve. And frankly, getting as many people in the room at once as possible to hear it at the same time, which is tricky. I remember we were on the shoot in a hangar in Santa Monica. We had a small little phone. We must have had 30 people literally around the phone there on the shoot and just saying, listen, everyone has to hear it and get on the same page and understand where we're coming from, because we all have a different starting point. Though we have the same end point, it's so important to understand what is your starting point and what you're trying to achieve and what the sensitivities are. I mean, the fact we're in a highly regulated industry, an industry with a lot of scrutiny, how we think about things is really different. So it partly was an education, and we couldn't take for granted that they would understand our starting point. You know, even what it was like to work with our lawyers was a really different process. So, you know, one of my lessons is when you start these projects is to spend a lot of time for people to understand your culture, how work gets done. We probably could have saved a little bit of time on the back end if there was a greater understanding and sensitivity to it, understand each other's environments to get there. And yeah, or to understand, you know, hey, the reason why we can't say that in legal disclosure is because of this. It's not because we don't want to do it, is because of X or Y, and more of an understanding. So it wasn't that we were taking a point of view on it, is to understand how the companies operate and what some of the, you know, just some of the things that we need to consider are.
And I think from Hill Holliday's perspective, it was critical because the band had to be happy, the bank had to be happy, Red had to be happy, we had to be happy. And I think in hindsight, a nice sort of end of the story, even though it's not over, is that over $3 million raised in 24 hours. So any misgivings I think that anyone had, which to their credit they kept quiet, I think pale in comparison to what we accomplished. Or I hope they do.
Any other questions? Okay, well, I'll just ask one more. I'd love for each of you to just share what the most rewarding moment for you personally was in working on this campaign.
You know, I can start with that, Jim. And, you know, I had, and I think you saw from some of the visuals, I recently was on the ground in Kenya. So I got to, working through this was just incredibly rewarding, but the ultimate reward was seeing the benefit of all the work and being on the ground. And there was one of the visuals where I'm in the home of a mother who delivered a child free of HIV because of the medication. And I got to meet this little girl and play with her. And I really got to see what the issue was. So you hear about, you know, the 40 cents a day, and that's all it takes. But when you get over there, you realize there's a couple other issues going on. One is the fact, the access. It's physically hard to get the drugs to the individuals. And the other part, the emotional part that I hadn't really thought about, because you hear about it rationally, it's 40 cents a day, is just the whole stigma to come out, to raise your hand, to get tested, and to recognize and realize you have HIV, and to deal with that, and to realize some of these funds go to counseling and to community workers to really build this community to help these people succeed and to reconcile the fact they have, then to take the drugs and to move on. And so just to see the impact of the money that we raised on the communities, on the people, and to see this woman who told us, that was the picture earlier, to say, she said to us, I was suicidal. And then I got the counseling, then I got the drugs, and now look, I have these beautiful children, and I'm back, I'm thriving again. And, you know, so when we talk about making financial lives better, one connection at a time, I feel like I'm living our purpose. What we did is saying, this is what we intended to do, and I got to see the impact firsthand.
Same question?
Yep, all the way down.
It's hard to point to any one specific moment or one specific instance or example of the most rewarding, because it's been pretty rewarding all along. I think that we're not done yet, and we need to keep the momentum going. And I'd like to think that the most rewarding moment would come ultimately when, you know, that the first AIDS-free generation is born.
Yeah, I mean, of course it's the impact that it has on the ground, but for me personally, I see my team and they work so crazy hard and they don't get paid that much money, and they take such pride. And when everybody was watching it, when it aired at the Super Bowl, everybody was sort of taking pictures of themselves watching it and this and that. And you know, to just see how moved everybody was, I know they're in for another 5 years. Like, you know, and so to me, that was incredibly rewarding because they could see that, you know, we could do something really, really big and have major, major impact.
All right, I think we're just now out of time. So please join me in thanking Meredith Spencer and Deborah. That's great.